Hello, dear viewers. Once again, you are most welcome to Standard High School Zana Virtual Classroom. Always visit the channel. Make sure you subscribe and hit the notification bell for instant updates. My name is Jonas Kumserza, Department of Economics, here at Standard High School Zana. We are continuing with our topic of inflation, and in the last episode we are looking at the theories of inflation, where we looked at the cost push inflation, where we say that cost push inflation is the persistent increase in the general price levels of goods and services in an economy as a result of rising costs of production. Then we also looked at demand pull inflation, where we said it is the persistent increase in the general or average price level of goods and services as a result of aggregate demand exceeding aggregate supply at full employment level of resources. And we had even tried to look at some of the causes of demand pull inflation, where we talked about increase in the wages of workers that increases their purchasing power. We also looked at the increase in the population size that increases aggregate demand. We also talked about excess issuance of currency that increases aggregate demand and increases money in circulation. We also talked about increased exportation of goods and services abroad that brings in more money, and that money increases aggregate demand at expense of aggregate supply. Then we also talk about increased inflow of income from abroad. When you find, you know, we have very many Ugandans living in diaspora, so many of them bring money here, and when that money comes here, the aggregate demand of people increase, and if it is not corresponded with supply, that money ends up leading into demand pull inflation. Also, we have a breakdown of production points or the natural calamities which reduce the production level. So when production level falls, aggregate supply declines. So if aggregate supply declines and aggregate demand increases, we end up in what we call demand pull inflation. The inflation is pulled by the demand. So we have to look at, in a way, to calm down this inflation, it is only through increasing aggregate supply. Also, another cause of demand pull inflation, we have reduced direct taxes, which leaves people with a lot of disposable income. You know, direct tax is meant to reduce the disposable income of an individual. So if they are reduced direct taxes, it means people are left with enough disposable income, which increases their purchasing power, and that leads to demand pull inflation. Also, we have uncontrolled credit creation. Uncontrolled credit creation, where you find that commercial banks giving out loans to people is not controlled. It means many people can access loans, have money, and as long as the population has money, aggregate demand increases. So, dear viewers, those are some of the causes of demand pool inflation.
Without forgetting that this demand pool inflation is not caused by any other factor,
but aggregate demand exceeding aggregate supply at full employment level of resources.
Now let's look at the measures or solutions that can be taken to reduce the demand pool inflation. Number one, we have to reduce the government expenditure. We have to reduce the government expenditure, especially on non-essential items. You know, the government sometimes spends on sectors or on issues that are non-essential, ending up splashing a lot of money in the public. And when people have money, we expect them to increase their purchasing power. Then we have to increase direct taxes so as to check on people's disposable incomes. We have to impose high direct taxes on people's income, which checks on their disposable income as well as their purchasing power. Then encouraging importation of essential goods that are highly demanded in the local market. Because when the demand on the local market is high, we have to back it by more supply from abroad. That's why we are saying encourage importation of essential goods to back up the local market. And especially, we have to look at those imports are from cheaper sources. Because if you don't do that, you will end up bringing in another form of inflation, which we shall see later. Then we also have to undertake restrictive monetary policy. You remember restrictive monetary policy from our topic of money and banking. Like increasing the bank rate, so that commercial banks are controlled. The money they have to give to the public is controlled. You find if the commercial banks go to the central bank to borrow, the rate is high. So there is limited liquidity in commercial banks. So less money goes to the what? To the public. And that checks on the aggregate demand of people. Then we also have to, the government must take wage control measures to ensure that the workers do not continuously demand for high wages, which finally leads into increasing aggregate demand, the purchasing power of people, and taking us into inflation. Then also, the government must put in place measures to control the population growth rate. So that is a demand pull inflation. Dear viewers and learners, especially out there, you need to know that this inflation is as a result of aggregate demand exceeding aggregate supply at full employment level of resources. So dear viewers, let's look at another theory of inflation, which is structural inflation. to inflation. Dear viewers, when we talk of structural inflation, we mean the persistent increase in the general price level of goods and services due to supply rigidities and structural bottlenecks in the sectors of the economy, leading to the decline in the supply of essential goods. This form of inflation one is brought by supply rigidities and structural bottlenecks. Bottlenecks or hindrances in the economy, leading to decline in supply of essential goods. Or, in simple terms, you can say structural inflation is a form of inflation as a result of supply rigidities in the economy. Or you can say it is the one caused by supply rigidities. But we also add there that also the structural bottlenecks in the sectors of the economy, leading to a decline in supply of essential goods. So this form of inflation, you can call it structural inflation or bottleneck inflation. So the inflation is not because of any other reason, but because of supply rigidities. They are obstacles that prevent the supply of essential goods. And what are those ones? So now that one takes us to the causes of bottleneck or structural inflation. Number one, we have the breakdown of infrastructure. Breakdown of infrastructure. Breakdown of infrastructure. Infrastructure like roads play a very big role in the movement of goods and services. So when there is a breakdown in infrastructure, like a road or a bridge from Arua to Kampala, when a bridge breaks down, it means the goods which come from Arua to Kampala and goods which come from Kampala to Arua will go on a standstill. So, because of such a rigidity, when goods don't reach where they are supposed to be, of course the demand exceeds the supply, and you expect prices to keep on skyrocketing. So that's what we call structural inflation. The breakdown in the infrastructure is a very, very big cause of structural inflation. We also have natural calamities. In the natural calamities, that's where we put even this pandemic of COVID. This pandemic of COVID also caused a supply rigidity. You see now on the road everywhere, there are roadblocks. So suppose somebody is delivering essential goods and the police at the traffic checkpoint stops him, that it is now past curfew time, but so it means the goods will not reach where they are supposed to go, and that will increase the prices of goods, and that's what we call structural inflation. Natural calamities like drought, floods, they affect agricultural production. If in an area where they grow, let's say matoke, they are hit by drought or they are hit by locusts. Remember recently we had invasion of locusts here, especially in the Karamoja sub region. So if such calamities hit agriculture, it means here in Kampala we shall not get the goods as we are supposed to get. There will be a supply rigidity, and that will of course increase prices of goods, leading to bottleneck inflation.